We were his teammates and we were afraid of him. And there was just fear.
That's more when I thought to you.
He was a jerk. He crossed the line numerous times. But as time goes on and you think back about what he was actually trying to accomplish, you're like, yeah, he was a hell of a teammate.
He was pushing us all to be better. Because he wanted to win. And guess what? It worked.
Welcome to the Ride On podcast presented by Ride On Sports. Today we're going to be discussing about Michael Jordan outside of basketball.
Michael Jordan is widely recognized as one of the greatest basketball players of all time. He was drafted in 1984 by the Chicago Bulls. After a few years, he won his first NBA Finals in 1991, one of many. He went on to win five more, cementing himself as the greatest of his generation.
To get us started, we're going to start off with shoes. After he was drafted, in 1985, he got signed to Nike and released the first Jordan 1 shoes, which retailed for about $100 million.
I think it's just crazy that he got signed right after he got drafted, because that's not really something common. And, like, he was good, but no one thought he was going to be that good.
Yeah, but all this... Well, Michael initially went to the signs with Adidas because it was more popular and he did like the brand better. But since Sonny got his mom to come around, he ended up signing with Nike.
And I think it's interesting because, like, Nike was not really a big shoe at the time. And now, like, Jordans are so much money. Nike is such a big company that, like, he really was the beginning of that company. I think it's really cool.
And it's also odd because, like, why would Nike just sign, like, a new player instead of somebody more popular?
Yeah,
to
and
get them more, like,
fans? He wasn't on a great team at the time. The Bulls weren't good. So it wasn't like he was going to win the NBA, like, win a championship his first year.
Yeah, his mom got him that amazing contract. In addition to the $2.5 million, he also got 25% royalties lifetime.
Yeah.
That ended up making him a billionaire.
I think it's also interesting that his, like, parents had so much kind of say, and, like, he was so close to them that even in his professional career, they were involved in things like that, and he listened to them, because a lot of people, like, what they wouldn't listen to their mom when signing a contract.
Especially, like, he's all off on his own now.
Yeah.
But he's still,
I personally love Jordans, and my favorites are 2s, 3s, and 11s, and I personally love 2s myself.
Yeah, I agree. I love the 1s. I think they're, like, just a really good classic. I also love how he wore them. I think in one of the All-Star games later in his career, I thought that was really cool to pay homage to, like, the beginning of his career.
I'm taking 4s personally. I think they have the best colorways. Thunder, Black Cats, those are all clean colorways.
I mean, the 1s are kind of all right, but I've never been, like, too big of a fan of Jordans. I kind of like the Nike Blazers more. Like, they seem kind of overhyped most of the time, too expensive for me.
I mean, I get what you're saying, but, like, they're not, Nike Blazers are not comfortable. Jordans are so much more comfortable, and they're just so original. I personally, like, before that, there were no shoes like that. I think they're just so original.
Yeah, they're
and so cool.
Classic.
Yeah, and you have to think about all the different designs that Jordan has.
So many options.
And the 1s were also great because he wore those in spite of the NBA rules. They weren't allowed to have that much color on shoes. They were only allowed to be white and a team color. He broke those rules and he took the fines.
And he released another shoe around it to make more marketing.
Right, and his commercials were also pretty cool. Like, he inspired a lot of people with them, made them want to be like him. And he got a lot of supporters from those. What were his commercials again?
Like, oh, yeah, there was, like, Gatorade, Wheeze. He had his Like Mike commercials, which I personally loved growing up.
Yeah, I love the Like Mike commercial because it, like, really, like, it was just about
him
being good on the court, because he was good, even though we're talking about off the court. Like, he was so crazy.
Yeah, that his first season was really revolutionary in terms of rookies. I mean, he made the All-Star team. He averaged 28 points. That was one of his best seasons. He won Rookie of the Year.
Yeah, I just think, and the commercials, I think, just really showed his character, and he was kind of like a family man. He wasn't seen out partying, doing bad things at the time. He just kind of stayed at home, played basketball, and made commercials with kids. So I think it really showed, like...
Yeah, I think they gave him a lot of, like, more supporters.
Yeah.
Made people like him more when he was, like, just starting out.
Yeah, and seeing him drink Gatorade made me want to drink Gatorade.
And there's actually a Gatorade commercial that is out now that has him at the end. I don't think it's him, but obviously, because it's him when he's younger.
AI.
Probably AI, but I think it's really
it's
cool that
like
even...
a throwback.
even now you could see him like in commercials, and that's like to his earlier ones. Really how influential he was in commercials.
Yeah, he was such a great player that rookie season. That the Bulls franchise was at a terrible point then. He really really brought them into the mainstream.
Making him like popular himself too.
Brought the Bulls back.
And I think he just brought like a good young energy on that team, because that team had like a lot of problems with illicit substances that they shouldn't be doing, and they were all kind of older. So having him be there and really not letting them lose and kind of being a driving force on that team inspired them. Even though they might have not won the finals or gone very far into the playoffs, they still had were like rejuvenated and re-energized by him.
He just made them better. Yeah. Like overall.
You know, there were so many kids who wanted to be like Mike, and I think that's where the movie Like Mike came from. And everybody loved the movie because it really encaptured the essence of the youth and how much they loved Michael Jordan. There was also Space Jam, where they featured his 11s and everything, and everybody, I think that was good marketing for him, talking about commercials and everything. But Space Jam really helped see, everybody got to see him play basketball.
And probably also made it more popular with, like, kids, because it was all, like, Looney Tunes and all that stuff, so a bunch of kids watched that and knew who he was.
And they're, like, funny movies. I, like,
I like the movies.
They're good movies all around, not just, like, Michael Jordan's in them. And I also think it's interesting, like, Space Jam, there's other basketball players, Charles Barkley, I'm forgetting the other ones, but there were other basketball players in them. So I think it just not only created a name for him, but like a name for the league at a time where they didn't want to be like considered with a certain image.
Yeah, he was also acting that movie while practicing for the 1996 season. I mean, he was doing that while he was working on his game.
True dedication to his fans.
Yeah, also the partnership with Spike Lee that he had and all of the things they did together. I think they did a movie. I think Spike Lee did a movie about him. I don't know if he was in it, but it just became a branding thing. And just, like, everybody knew him. Everyone was connected to him. And it was just, like, a household name at that point. Everybody knew what who he was and how he acted.
Yeah, he transcended basketball at that point. I mean, He had delved so much into media outside of the game. He became really a household name.
And he's one of the first players to ever do that, really, to connect with fans off the court and connect with people outside of basketball.
Like, not just a player.
Not just as a player, and not just connecting with, like, media and news reporters.
Yeah, and he also gave a lot of insight to how it was behind the scenes while playing basketball with the many documentaries he has, like the movie Air. And we really got a chance to see as fans how he got signed and what really went down as he was signing to Nike.
And the more recent movie, Air, about how he signed with Nike, I think that really popularized him again in a more recent era.
Yeah, I also think, like, all the movies and how people say, like, how he acted outside. He was very professional, and I think we can credit that a lot to the college he went to. Obviously, he went to UNC and played under Coach Dean, who was obviously a great coach, but, like, that program was really well-run, and outside of basketball, I think that he coached them to be good people and good, like, gentlemen.
Yeah, because they did run a pretty clean program.
Yeah, and it was, like, a popular program, so they wanted to – they're representing the college. They have to represent the college well.
And him coming out of there, like, being great, made it popular.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Dean ran that UNC team like an NBA team. I think it really helped prepare Michael for his rookie season, and that's why there wasn't much of a shock when he first came into the NBA.
Yeah, because he really pushed Michael, because he used to tell him, like, Michael told him, I really want to be good, and he was like, you have to work harder than you did in high school.
And actually, I think it's interesting that Michael didn't want to leave after his junior year at UNC. He wanted to come back again, but that his coaches saw his talent and saw his potential and, like, said, you know, you really have a good opportunity to be great, and they really pushed him to go to the next level and not stay where he's comfortable.
And I think his experience in college really prepared him for those years. He didn't really see much success in his early years because of the Pistons, the Bad Boys. Mm-hmm. But then once he got past them, he started winning a lot. In 1991, he won his first finals. He repeated again in 1992, and then that summer was when the Olympics in Barcelona were going to happen. In that time, U.S. Olympic basketball was only college players. Those college players weren't doing very well internationally. So that 1992 Barcelona Olympics, they decided to allow NBA players to come in for the first time. and a lot of them were recruited. Jordan, Ewing, Barkley,
Johnson,
Magic, Larry Bird, a lot of them came to play. That team really threw basketball into the international scene. Before that, basketball wasn't much of an international sport, but internationally, Michael Jordan was so popular that he really inspired a lot of youth internationally. That team really inspired kids to play worldwide.
There was probably a lot of pressure on all the NBA players in the Olympics for the first time. Like a new experience. I'm not used to it because it was just college players before that.
And I just think it's, like, interesting. Obviously, a lot of people call them the Dream Team, but, like, they really were. When you look at the roster, right. They were stacked.
All
like
the
they,
greatest players.
Jordan,
in the NBA at the time.
Larry Bird, Magic, Ewing, Pippen. Like, I think there was only crazy. One college player on it. Pretty sure it was Christian Laettner from mm-hmm. Duke. And he didn't see a lot of playing time. He wasn't that big a part of it. But it was just crazy how much it changed from one Olympic to the next.
Right.
I think that's really when a lot of fans worldwide came from and started watching the NBA more.
Yeah, and even now, like, the ratings internationally for the NBA are higher than they are in the USA because yeah. of that team. And I think that's still the reason that it's so popular outside of our country.
So many of the successful NBA players now come from Europe. Nikola Jokic from Serbia, Luka Doncic from Slovenia. Giannis Antetokounmpo from Greece. I think Michael really helped the worldwide race.
I also think it's interesting that in that Olympics, Michael Jordan and Scottie Pippen played, I'm forgetting his name, Tony Kukoc, who was in talking to the Bulls about signing. And at the time, they didn't like him because they were talking about replacing, quote-unquote, replacing Michael and Scotty with Tony Kukoc and as like the new star of the Bulls, and they were hard on him in those Olympics. And then a few short years later, he was on the Bulls winning NBA Finals with him.
Anyways, the Dream Team makes me think about his gambling problem too, because that's when he really got into it and started getting addicted, no matter how much he lied and denied it. But during the Dream Team, that's when it started getting bad for him.
Yeah, and I just think the whole gambling thing, like, I mean, a lot of professional athletes gamble, and even I think that just because of his background of everyone thinking, oh, he's, like, so perfect, he's a family man, he's
right.
a dad, it just, like, got blown out of proportion because a lot of these athletes gamble, no one's perfect, and
yeah.
it's, like, he says he didn't do it a lot, I trust him, so I think that we should all just give him some grace.
I mean, there was his whole scandal where he lost a lot of money.
Well, he has a lot of money to spare. Like,
well, that's true, but...
Yeah, I think... I think his gambling problem really stemmed from his competitiveness, because a lot of that was in his golf game, and he was a ruthless competitor, as you could see on the basketball court, but also he ended up making really large bets on golf games.
Right. And there was some evidence that his gambling even dated back to high school, which is kind of crazy when you think about it, because you think how he started in the NBA or whatever because he was getting competitive, but it really started a while back, more than people think.
I also think, like, people say, oh, his gambling was so bad, but it wasn't like he ever gambled on his own basketball games or on basketball games at all, really.
Right.
So it wasn't like he was affecting his play. It was on golf. It didn't involve the NBA.
It didn't affect his team.
Exactly. People like Pete Rose, the White Sox scandal, Black Sox scandal, not White Sox, like, they threw games. They intentionally did things that affected sports and affected their team. Michael Jordan just did it for golf. It was a personal thing, so I don't understand why it became such a public issue.
Yeah, it was a problem, but it wasn't like
just
a legal problem. Yeah.
Like,
yeah. He just had a gambling problem.
Right. Like, he was once in $1.2 million in debt from gambling on golf, which is crazy, and it could just affect him mentally as well, which could be bad for his team.
I also think that people don't realize, like, how much money he actually has. So a certain amount of money of him is a different amount of money of us, because he has more of it. So if you have $100, $20 is more valuable to somebody that has $1 million.
Yeah, so I think that what you're saying, Gene, about like how it affected his mentality, I really don't think it affected him that much. And so it really didn't affect his team or himself while he was playing on the court.
Yeah, true.
Said, like,
okay.
Said
so his father unfortunately passed away when he was in a car. He was in a car taking a nap, I believe, and he was murdered. There was no real evidence that the person was murdering him because he was Michael Jordan's father. It just seemed to be that they were murdering somebody and he happened to be in the wrong place at the wrong time. And after his father was murdered, Michael Jordan actually decided to retire from basketball for a year in 1995 and play professional baseball because his father growing up always wanted him to play baseball. So he took a year, he got signed with the White Sox, he played in the White Sox minor league system, and he was not that good, not that bad, but he attracted a lot of press, and I thought it was interesting that he could just give everything up for what happened.
Yeah, and I think what you're saying with his competitiveness, he was really dedicated to baseball as well and trying his best, even though it wasn't his main sport. Just, I think it was because really his dad wanted it, like you said, so I think he really did give it his all when he was playing.
Yeah, and Mike Huff, former White Sox outfielder, said that he was the greatest basketball player of all time, and he was looking at Mike Huff and saying, teach me, which he really thought was admirable because he was such a coachable person and so open to learning new things, especially in baseball.
Right. It is kind of crazy that he just drops, like, his whole entire career just do baseball. Like, it's really weird, kind of like he had a mental break there.
Well, he already had like that three-peat. I think he could have been content with just that, because he wasn't very good in baseball.
He was not that good. I have some stats here. He had an average of 111 errors, struck out 114 times. However, he also had 30 stolen bases and 51 RBIs. So I mean, it wasn't the worst.
Wait, how long did he play?
Only for a year.
In the minors. Never even got called up. That's crazy.
Yeah, he actually decided to quit. There was a player strike for the MLB in 1995, and they were looking for replacement players to play in the MLB, and he just decided that was the end of his baseball career. A lot of the players that were getting called up were actually people that could play in the MLB, and he just didn't think it was his place to take one of their spots. So then he went back to the Bulls in 1996.
I mean, I feel like at a point he just realized that's not what he's meant to do.
Yeah.
He just goes back to basketball.
And Bulls coach Phil Jackson actually said that when he came back, he was more generous with his time and more encouraging to his teammates because he historically wasn't, not a bad teammate, but was kind of
people
harsh.
Said he was
harsh.
Kind of,
yes,
yeah,
that's a good
kind of
word
a jerk
for it.
Sometimes,
but yeah, so
he just motivated everybody.
I also think that year of baseball kind of made him realize how much he does love basketball, how much the Bulls and his teammates meant to him, and how, like, what he had and the talent he had was so special.
Right. Probably also realized that, like, his father would just be happy with him doing his passion, what he wants to do.
Yeah,
I agree. Really mind if he didn't play baseball.
And I think the little time that he did spend playing baseball really did show the connection that he had with his parents and his dad, which is why he transferred for a little bit.
Yes, I agree.
In those two seasons that he wasn't playing basketball, the Bulls still had Scottie Pippen and Dennis Rodman, two of the great supporting players of all time. They couldn't win the finals because of course, Hakeem and the Knicks at the time. But when Michael came back, they were still a great team. I mean, they were looked at as a real threat. In 1996, they won the finals, and in 97, they won the finals again. Now, at that time, tensions were really building up between Jerry Krause, the general manager, Phil Jackson, and the big three, and Michael, Scotty, and Dennis. That season was really looked at as possibly the last season that they could play together, because Jerry did say that this was going to be Phil Jackson's last season as the coach, and Michael was not willing to play for the Bulls after. And recently, there was a documentary about that season called The Last Dance.
Yeah, which the name came from, that coach.
I think The Last Dance was great. I watched it, I think, twice. It was really interesting. I liked how it was about Michael, and there were also, like, episodes about Scottie Pippen, Dennis Rodman, Steve Kerr, because they were really important, and obviously being on the team with Michael, they were going to be seen kind of, I hate to say it, but background characters, because they weren't Michael Jordan, and they were always going to be outshined by him. So I think it was interesting that they showed their stories as well. And I think it was interesting seeing the front office and how they treated like their players, because even though he's Michael Jordan, Jerry Krause was still hard on him in certain things.
Like, it really showed their all, like, their relationship as, like, players and, like, as a team and how they got along.
Yeah, I agree. And I just think that the whole thing with Phil Jackson as well showed how he connected with his players and how good of, like, a person he was off the court, as Michael Jordan was literally willing to quit his job with one of the best basketball teams ever just to play for Phil Jackson.
Yeah, and I really do think that shows where he really does value his coaching, and it shows that when he plays, because the dedication he had to not play if it wasn't him really showed how much he loved his team and Phil Jackson.
It shows how he wants to, like, still get pushed and get better, even though he's, like, already famous and great.
And he didn't believe that any other coach could do that for him but Phil Jackson.
Yeah, they still were very successful, even with all the tension between the management and the players. They ended up winning that 98 finals against the Jazz. That was one of the most impactful seasons of Michael Jordan's career, because that was known to be the last one with the Bulls, and he ended up retiring.
Yeah, I also just think that it was kind of poetic. A lot of people thought that they wouldn't be able to do it. A lot of people thought that they were going to dismantle that team, trade Scottie Pippen, who at one point in the season refused to come off the injured list unless he was traded or had more money. So I think that it really just showed how Michael was really a driving force in teams and how much influence he had on players and on coaches to be able to win even after everything that happened.
Yeah, he saw winning as happening no matter what. He didn't see any lose wasn't in his vocabulary.
Yeah. So now that we have gone over almost everything that he did outside of his basketball playing career, we're going to share some of our final opinions. So I'll start. I personally think that what he did off the court almost outweighed what he did on the court. Obviously, he won a lot, but everything he did outside of basketball really showed how he influenced the game and how he spread its popularity and kind of created a reputation of winning and being a good person at the same time. So I think that's really admirable, and I think that's something that we might never see again in basketball. No matter how good of a player they are, they'll never have the same impact or change the game as much as he did.
I absolutely agree with you, Mimi. I personally love what he did on and off the court, and I really do think for the people who do call him their GOAT, I think he really does deserve the title, because he really did show the dedication to his fans, his coaches, the game. He really did want the success that he had.
He completely changed the game. Of course, today we talked about how amazing international players are. That Dream Team, which was really led by him, I mean, it was so impactful all across the world. But also, his gambling problems were not the best. He really, I don't know how good of an influence he was on the kids he inspired off of the basketball court. He wasn't really the best person.
Right, like, his gambling really bothered me. Like, he needs to start saying stop, get some help to himself, you know what I mean? Like, he was overall a pretty good influence, but he still did some wrong things in his career, like his gambling, and he kind of rode on Pippen and Rodman a little bit. Like, they did a lot to help him. Like, Michael was a great player, but he also needed help from his team. Like, he wasn't, like, solo. So he was a pretty good player, and he had some good insights, and he also kind of deserted his team for a year when he went to go play in the minors for baseball. So he kind of left his team alone for a little while, and the other players had to carry the team for a whole year without him. It also kind of surprised me that he just, like, went back just like that a year later, and, like, nobody, like, said anything about that. Like, he was just back right away and back into the team and into the family. Like, he made some good influences on others, but there's just some things about him that I can't get past.
Now that we've presented our final opinions, thank you for listening to the Right On Podcast presented by Right On Sports.
Bye!
Bye!